everyone. Welcome back to Catholicism. Wow. So today I'm going to take a look at a video from Pastor Mike Winger. This video is not from Pastor Mike's podcast. This is from some other podcast that he appears to be a guest on. And I'm sorry, I don't know what podcast that is. If somebody knows, you can let me know in the comments section. But this is just a real short clip. I've been a fan of Pastor Mike's for a long time. I do not just surround myself with Catholic YouTubers and Catholic teachers. I like to watch a wide variety of videos and expose myself to everything that's out there, because that's how you discover the truth. That's how you discern the truth from the deception. And that's ultimately what led me out of Protestantism and into the Catholic Church in the first place. Because when you really look at things with an open mind and you really look at evidence and facts and reason, it's just plain that Catholicism is biblically accurate, it's historically true, and it is the church that goes back to Jesus Christ and the apostles. There are a lot of Protestant YouTubers out there that are extremely hateful. They're anti-Catholic, they're bigoted, they're just all around, they don't exhibit open-mindedness or Christian values. I don't believe that those things apply to Pastor Mike Winger. I think in a lot of things, Pastor Mike is very open-minded and is very open to what does the Bible actually say. For some reason, though, Pastor Mike seems to have blinders on when it comes to Catholicism. I have seen so many different Pastor Mike Winger videos on Catholicism and responses from Trent Horn and responses from Michael Lofton and responses from How to Be Christian. And Pastor Mike does not seem to really be open to the critiques of actual Catholics. And that's a shame. I really wish, and I don't know if Pastor Mike is going to see this, I will be tagging him in it, as I tend to tag most everybody that I do responses of, because I'm not trying to dunk on anybody. I'm trying to sincerely engage and have a conversation. And I don't know if Pastor Mike is going to watch this video, but I would very much like to address him personally, because I think that that he is, on this topic, he's very close-minded, and I don't know why that is when he's so open-minded on everything else, even when it seems to be controversial. He has a wonderful video on whether or not Christians should drink alcohol, and it's very balanced, it's very biblical, it's correct. Everything he says in that video is just absolutely correct. The good things and the bad things. And I just don't understand why he can't have that same energy when it comes to Catholicism. I'm also extremely disappointed that Pastor Mike chose not to engage with Trent Horn. And I understand that he feels that Trent Horn is a much better debater than he is. I don't want to debate Trent Horn either. But at the end of the day, Trent Horn is open to a wide variety of formats. It doesn't have to be a formal debate. Pastor Mike, if you are watching this video, I would encourage you to find some Catholic, even if it's not Trent Horn, find some Catholic to have on your show and just have an informal discussion with them. You know, talk to them about your concerns and listen to their responses to your concerns. And take their responses to heart. Then I'm not saying that you have to agree with them. I'm not saying that you have to become a Catholic after you have this conversation. All I'm saying is actually look at the evidence, actually look at the scriptures, and actually listen to reason. And hopefully, hopefully we can engage with some of those things today in this video. So in this clip, Pastor Mike is talking about the Eucharist and how he believes that an examination of the Jewish Passover refutes the idea that the Eucharist is literal, and that it seems to confirm that when Jesus said at the Last Supper, "This is my body," that he was speaking metaphorically. And hopefully, using scripture and plain reason, we can disillusion him of that opinion, because it's incorrect. And I'll show you why it's incorrect and why his topology is incorrect and why other scriptures show that when Jesus instituted the Last Supper, when he instituted the Eucharist at the Last Supper, that he did mean for it to be real, and that it was real, and that it's still real today. So let's take a look at this clip of Pastor Mike Winger and see what he thinks.
So our next question comes from Carolina X. Rose, and they say, "Hi, Mike. Question regarding the Lord's Supper. I was discussing Lord's Supper with a Catholic friend following Easter and hadn't realized how differently we viewed it. Protestants believe communion is symbolic, while Catholics believe Christ is physically and spiritually present in the Eucharist. My understanding is that this stems from a disagreement about whether Jesus was speaking literally or metaphorically at the Last Supper. Jesus used a lot of metaphors, but his comparison of bread to his body and wine to his blood was immediately followed by prayer participation in the act described in that metaphor. I know that when Jesus said, 'I am the vine, you are the branches,' he didn't subsequently go literally prune a tree. And when he said he was the light of the world, he didn't invite everyone into the dark room and light a candle. So this made me curious, besides the Lord's Supper, were any of Jesus's other metaphors immediately followed by the physical representation and participation of those metaphors? Thank you so much."
So right off the bat here, we have the claim that Jesus spoke in metaphors a lot. And he did. Jesus said, "I am the vine and you are the branches." Jesus said, "I am the door." Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." None of those things he meant literally. Those things are all allegorical and metaphor. He is the door because he's the way by which we can enter the kingdom of God. However, whenever somebody was confused and Jesus was speaking in metaphor, he always, always, always clarified himself. Okay? So think about the discourse that he had with Nicodemus in John chapter 3. When Jesus told Nicodemus that in order to enter the kingdom of heaven, he must be born again, Nicodemus asked him, "But how can I, as an old man, re-enter my mother's womb and be born again?" And Jesus was like, "No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is you have to be born of water and the Spirit. You have to be baptized. That's how you become born again, not by re-entering your mother's womb." He clarified himself. When Jesus speaks of his body, when he says, "My flesh is true food and my blood is true drink," we'll see in the scripture later on, because I am going to read it, he does not clarify himself, and people turn away from him. So this idea that Jesus spoke in metaphor sometimes does not mean that anything that you don't understand or that you don't agree with, you can just chalk up to being metaphorical. It just doesn't stand up.
I'm trying to think about the metaphors followed by physical. I don't know if we could say there's a parallel there, but let me explain a couple things that might help us answer why I don't think that this is literal. That the initial Passover was not meant to be understood by Jesus or the disciples as a literal transformation of the bread into the body of Christ physically and the wine into the blood of Christ, at least the substance versus the accident, if you want to borrow from Catholic philosophy and understanding of metaphysics and stuff. So
right off the bat, I want to give Pastor Mike his due credit for actually knowing and understanding the Catholic terminology. He made the distinction between the substance and the accident. I have a video where I explain how the television show Quantum Leap illustrates what we mean by the accidents versus the substance in reference to the Eucharist. In short, it's basically that they describe on the show Quantum Leap, they describe what happens to Sam Beckett when he leaps into someone as he is being surrounded by their aura, which is why he looks and sounds like them. But it's deeper than that, because we see Dr. Beckett in some episodes going through medical examinations, and nobody's like, hey, how come his blood type is different? And we see Dr. Beckett as a double amputee, and even though he can stand, someone could go up and walk up to him and put their hands on his nubs and not feel that he has legs, even though he himself can stand up because he has those legs. They're there, but they're not. The people around him do not have the ability to perceive those legs. It goes much deeper than he just appears as this other person. On the outward sign, he retains the accidents of the person he's leapt into. But on the inside, he is 100% the substance of Dr. Sam Beckett. And this is illustrated by an episode where he leaps into a man who is engaged in slight premarital relations with a woman that he's going to be married to the next day. And Dr. Beckett leaps into this person right at the moment of climax, and this woman gets pregnant, and it's revealed that the baby she has isn't the baby of the person that Dr. Beckett leaped into. That baby is Dr. Beckett's baby, because the substance of Dr. Beckett was there, even though the accidents of the person he leaped into remained. And that's what it's like with the Eucharist. It is 100% the substance of the body and blood of Christ and soul and divinity and the whole Christ. But we still perceive it as bread and wine. If you were to give it a scientific analysis, it would test as bread and wine. And I get that this is confusing for people who are, for lack of a better word, uninitiated. But hopefully the Quantum Leap metaphor helps. Also, I should point out that it's not proper to use the word literal. In order for the bread and the wine to literally become the body and blood of Christ, that would include the accidents. It's much more accurate to say real. It really becomes the body and blood of Christ. Literally, the word literally takes it just a step too far. So I would encourage Catholics to stop using the term literally in reference to the Eucharist, because it's not exactly accurate. It really is just a step farther than what the Church and the Bible actually teaches.
All right, here's some things. What this does, I think we come to the passage with the debate in our head that is this the physical body and blood of Christ? And when we come with that, especially if you come from a Roman Catholic perspective, you're coming with the teaching you've received, and you've been told over and over again, this is my body means physically this has actually become. In fact, they're words of invocation in Roman Catholicism. When they say these phrases, the bread literally physically transforms into the body of Christ. And this is anachronism. I'm bringing a doctrine with me into the text. The question I should have is, what does it look like in a first century Jewish context? Not what does it look like in the middle of the 1500s and the Reformation?
Now, I'm not sure exactly why Pastor Mike brought up the mid-1500s and the Protestant Reformation, unless he's acknowledging that the symbolic view of the Eucharist did not exist until it was proposed by Huldrych Zwingli during the Protestant Reformation. For the first 1500 years of church history, it was universally believed that the Eucharist was really the body and blood of Christ. And that's why, you know, Lutherans still hold that view, Anglicans still hold that view. It was the traditional historical view of the church, and it wasn't until Zwingli that anyone believed anything differently.
creation. So when I look at it like that, I see something really interesting. In the Jewish, not the Renaissance European context, but in the Jewish context, Passover itself is a special meal that already has a ton of significance, and it's all symbolic. So it was called Passover because it was about, that symbolized the angel passing over so they would escape from judgment. They would eat unleavened bread because that symbolized the haste with which the Israelites had to flee Egypt. They had to leave in haste, and they didn't have time to leaven the bread. And the bitter herbs, they would eat bitter herbs at the meal too, and that represented the bitterness, the taste of the bitter herbs, the bitterness of bondage that they experienced under the Egyptians to remember what God had brought them out of. The lamb represented a sacrificial substitute that they weren't like making. There was no actual angel to pass over them year by year. This was just in commemoration of a previous suffering lamb. So the Jewish context, I think, means that Jesus is speaking symbolism. He's offering them a new Passover meal, a new meaning to an old Passover meal. The bread is Jesus's body, the wine is his blood. He's giving them a new covenant. He's showing that he's bringing out a new people through his blood, and there's a new commemoration of that, just like Passover was the commemoration of the founding of the nation of Israel. There's no doctrine in Judaism that the lamb offered becomes the literal flesh of lambs from the first Passover. Like, there's no doctrine that says this. There's no transubstantiation in Passover in the Jewish context. So when Jesus says, "This is my body," there it's in a feast that's steeped in symbolism. Symbolism is the context through which he gives it. So here's more, if I can add more to, I think this is a pretty strong argument actually against the Roman Catholic view here.
I'm sorry, Pastor Mike, but that's really not a strong argument at all. The reason why that's not a strong argument is because one has very little to do with the other. See, Pastor Mike has this problem where he thinks for an Old Testament type to be true, that it must be an exact one-to-one parallel to the New Testament thing that it's supposed to prefigure. And that's just not what we see. That's just not an accurate view. There are several types in the Old Testament that prefigure things in the New Testament in different ways. Some types come together to prefigure a New Testament thing. Some types prefigure several different New Testament things, and it doesn't have to be a one-to-one comparison, right? So, yes, the Passover did prefigure the New Covenant. It did prefigure how the blood of Christ will save God's people. However, it is not a one-to-one comparison. And to sit here and say that it has to be is just, you're going to confuse yourself and you're going to lead yourself into error by expecting it to be that one-to-one comparison. So we will see in a few minutes when I go to the scriptures. In John chapter 6, Jesus also compares himself, his flesh, to the bread from heaven, the manna that was given to the Israelites on their journey. Yes, Jesus is the fulfillment of the Passover lamb. That's why Jesus is called the Lamb of God. However, he is also the fulfillment of the bread from heaven. And in both of these comparisons, you actually ate the Passover lamb, and you actually ate the bread from heaven. And this goes back to how the Ark of the Covenant prefigures the Blessed Virgin. Mary is the new Ark of the Covenant, and within her are all of the contents of the old Ark of the Covenant in the person of Jesus Christ. So the Ark of the Covenant contained the staff of Aaron, the royal priesthood. It contained the Ten Commandments, the Word of God, and it contained manna, the bread of life, the bread from heaven. All of these things prefigure Jesus Christ, and she was the vessel that contained him, the same that the Ark of the Covenant was the vessel that contained those things. And this is also an Old Testament type that Pastor Mike rejects, but he doesn't really have good reasons for rejecting it. I mean, Pastor Mike, please, please explain to me how those two things don't prefigure each other. Pastor Mike, in another video where he is trying to refute Marian dogmas and whatnot, you know, he clearly doesn't get that type, that Old Testament types don't have to be a one-to-one comparison to the New Testament thing that they prefigure. And in order to truly understand biblical typology, you have to understand that. You have to understand that there doesn't always have to be a one-to-one comparison. And that several things can come together to create a New Testament fulfillment of an Old Testament type. And we see this in Jesus Christ. Yes, he is the metaphorical Lamb of God, but he is also the literal bread from heaven. And he says as much as in John chapter 6.
Another thought is, why didn't the disciples put up a fight? Like, why didn't they even ask? Like, hey, you know, Jesus, eating physical flesh is definitely against Torah. Like, are you sure you want me to do this? And you're like, well, they wouldn't do that because they trusted God. Yeah, but look at the same guy, Peter, who's there at the meal, when he has the vision, just a vision. It's a vision. It's not even like real, right? He has a vision of the coming down of all these different unclean animals. And God says, kill and eat. And Peter says to God, like, no, Lord, I've never eaten anything unclean. And yet this to them would at least strike that same kind of note and cause them to probably say, wait, Jesus, what do you mean? This is your body? Like, literally? This is your body now, literally? So I don't think they're thinking transubstantiation because they didn't put up a fight. They saw it as symbolic because it's connected to a meal full of symbolism. And there, it brings up other problems, like consuming Jesus at the Passover before his sacrifice even took place. Like, they're consuming the flesh of Christ? He hasn't even been sacrificed yet. So I think that should answer that question, I hope. Yeah.
Jesus's disciples did question this teaching. And this seems to be another example of Protestants ignoring the scriptures that are inconvenient to their worldview. Pastor Mike is focused so much on the Last Supper and on the comparisons to the Passover that he's completely ignoring everything that happened in John chapter 6, where Jesus had originally explained to his disciples, to the 12, to the apostles, what was going on. So no, they didn't question him at the Last Supper because they already knew what was going on because they had already had this discourse in John chapter 6. A reading from the Gospel according to John chapter 6, verses 22 through 71. On the next day, the people who remained on the other side of the sea saw that there had been only one boat there, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. However, boats from Tiberias came near the place where they ate the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when people saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum seeking Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? Jesus answered them, Truly, truly, I say to you, you seek me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not labor for food which perishes, but for the food which endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him has God the Father set his seal. Then they said to him, What must we do to be doing the work of God? Jesus answered them, This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent. So they said to him, Then what sign do you do that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus then said to them, Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven. My Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, Lord, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall not hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet you do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and him who comes to me I will not cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. The Jews then murmured at him, because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven. They said, Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, I have come down from heaven? Jesus answered them, Do not murmur among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God, and everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father, except him who is from God, he who has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, How can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who eats me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not such as the fathers ate and died. He who eats this bread will live forever. This he said in the synagogue as he taught at Capernaum. Many of his disciples, when they heard it, said, This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it? But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples murmured at it, said to them, Do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is of no avail. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But there are some of you that do not believe. For Jesus knew from the first who those were that did not believe, and who it was that would betray him. And he said, This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by the Father. After this, many of his disciples drew back and no longer walked with him. Jesus said to the 12, Will you also go away? Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. Jesus answered them, Did I not choose you, the 12, and one of you is a devil? He spoke of Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, for he, one of the 12, was to betray him. The Gospel of the Lord. And as for how Jesus could give his body and blood to his disciples before he'd even been sacrificed, before he'd even been crucified, well, that's just a miracle. And it boggles my mind when Protestants take this kind of skeptical attitude, because all you're telling me is that you don't believe in miracles. All you're telling me is that you don't believe that God is all-powerful, right? It's only laughable to you that Jesus could offer his real body and blood to his 12 disciples at the Last Supper before he's ever even crucified, that's only laughable to you, because at the end of the day, you can't possibly believe that God is all powerful. And this biblical view of the Last Supper is exactly 100% in line with what the Catholic Church teaches on the subject of the Eucharist. It's not a re-sacrifice. It's a representation of the sacrifice once and for all on Calvary. And where we can share in that moment, 2,000 years later, the disciples, the apostles, shared in that moment the night before it even happened, because God is timeless. So I hope this was helpful. I hope if Pastor Mike sees this video, that it's helpful to him. I pray so much that he can open his heart and open his mind and just actually, with a pure heart and an open mind, just examine the scriptures, examine history, examine the church fathers, and do it in such a way that you just want to know the truth. Discern the truth, and the Holy Spirit will show it to you. So thank you, everybody, for joining me. Do all the YouTube things. Like, share, subscribe. Share this video with your friends. Share my channel with your friends. I'm up to 134 subscribers now. So, I mean, whatever you guys are doing, it's working. So keep doing it. Thanks for being with me today, and have a great day.